Hello and welcome to the session. This is Professor Farhat. In this session, we would look at the fair value hedge under IFRS 9. In the prior session, we looked at the cash flow hedge. So matter of fact, I'm going to be using the same example that I illustrated for the cash value hedge, except I'm going to be assuming we're going to be treating this position as a fair value hedge. As always, I would like to remind you to connect with me on LinkedIn. If you haven't done so, YouTube is where you would need to subscribe. I have 1,500 plus accounting, auditing, and tax lecture. If you like my lecture, please like them. Press on the like button. This is important for me. Put them in playlist. Share them. Let the world know about them. If they're benefiting you, it means they might benefit other people. This is my Instagram account. Please follow me on Instagram as I'm trying to grow my following. And this is my Gumroad account, and I do have a website. I do recommend, if you're studying for an exam, to use studypal.co. It's an artificial intelligence-driven study buddy platform that matches you, if you're studying for your CPA, CFA, or any other exam for that matter, with a study buddy or groups. You can find study buddies and groups in 85 countries and 2,500 cities. This is the link. I strongly suggest to use them. So let's go back and talk about the fair value accounting. Under fair value accounting, because remember, we have to account for our hedges at fair value. Once we have a fair value, it means we have to determine either the profit or the loss to determine where do they go. And remember, we have two type of fair value hedging. We have, if you are a gambler or a speculator, any profit or loss goes on the income statement. Now, if you have a hedging position and that's to protect your asset, or protect your liabilities, or protect your cash flow, here you have to decide whether you're going to designate this hedge as a fair value hedge or as a cash flow hedge. Now, we talked about those in the prior session, explaining what this cash flow hedge means, what this fair value hedge means. This is basically a review. In the prior session, we looked at a cash flow hedge. In this session, we will see how we account for fair value hedge. And to be more specific, here are the steps for fair value hedge. This is what we're going to be working today. The hedged asset or liability is adjusted to fair value according to the spot rate, and any income or loss is recognized in net income. The derivative hedging instrument is adjusted to fair value also as an asset or a liability, with the counterpart recognized as a gain or a loss in net income. This is the fair value hedge. The cash flow hedge had four steps. It was much, much more involved. You will notice the fair value hedge is simpler. It's much simpler than the cash flow hedge. Then we're going to be looking at the same example this way. If you're interested, look in the description or in this playlist and you will find the cash flow hedge. We're going to be working with the same example. Exim Co. shipped goods to a Spanish customer on December 1st, year one, with the payment to be received March 1st. Assume December 31st, the spot rate is $1.50. Remember, this is, we already went through this example. So in case I'm going a little bit fast, it's because of this. And by December 31st, the euro appreciated the $1.51. So here's the entry that we make on the date of the sale. On the date of the sale, we book the receivable and we book the sale at the spot rate, which is $1.50. Why? Because we're going to be receiving 1 million euros. $1.50 is the rate. So our account receivable is $1.5 million. So record the sale at the spot rate. Now, on December 31st, the euro appreciated, it became $1.51. We had a gain of $10,000. So we increased the receivable, $10,000, and we increased our gain by $10,000, the foreign currency gain. And this goes on the income statement. This is to adjust the USD value of the euro receivable. Then on March 1st, the exchange rate was $1.48. At this point, we have a loss because it was $1.51 at December 31st, went down to $1.38. We lost 3 pennies times a million. We have a loss of $30,000. Therefore, we debit foreign exchange loss, which is other income or expense, and credit the receivable, reduce the receivable to $1,480,000. Now the receivable is $1,480,000. We receive the cash, $1,480,000. Then we remove the receivable for $1,480,000. So notice in this example, we did not use any protection by a forward contract or any option or any other method. So we did not hedge. So this is what happened. As a result, simply put, if you're going to look at it, we're supposed to receive $1.5 million. We receive $1,480,000. So the net loss is $20,000. Now we're going to enter into a contract to protect this position. However, we're going to enter into a hedge contract and assume it's a fair value hedge. So assume on December 31st, the 3-year forward rate is $1.485, and we sign a contract with First National Bank to deliver 1 million euros in 3 months in exchange for 1,000,485. So what we did, we don't want to wait and be surprised on March 1st. We went to First National Bank and we told them we'd like to buy this forward contract, and notice it's at a discount. Now the first thing I want to tell you is we ignore the discount. We don't amortize the discount under the fair value. So under the fair value, we don't worry about the discount, which is easier. Like in the cash flow hedge, we had to amortize the discount. On December 31st, no cash change hand, we just enter into a contract. Now, Eskimo, the same thing as the cash flow hedge. They have to account for the foreign currency transaction and the related forward contract simultaneously but separately. So we're going to have a receivable, and we're going to have a sale, or also we're going to have a hedging instrument, and those are accounted for separately. So let's go ahead and start to book the transaction, assuming we have a fair value hedge. So first, we're going to go ahead and debit receivable 1.5 million, credit sales 1.5 million. Now assume that the company decide not to designate the forward contract as a cash flow like the prior example, but instead we're going to treat it as a fair value hedge. What does that mean? It means in this case, gains and losses of the forward contract is taken directly to net income, and there's no amortization of the original discount. So now all the gains and the losses will go into net income versus the cash flow hedge. They went to the balance sheet, then eventually they were recycled. Okay, there's no formal entry for the forward contract. Basically, what we do is basically a memorandum would be prepared designating the forward contract as a hedge of the risk of the change in the fair value of the foreign currency receivable resulting from the change in the US dollar euro exchange rate. And we have to document this. Remember, for to be considered hedged accounting, we have to document all of this. Okay, remember the documentation in this memorandum is very important from a theoretical perspective. Now let's go ahead and start to look at what happened on December 31st. Remember, December 31st, the euro went up to $1.51. So the euro was $1.51. So what do we have if the euro is $1.51? Our receivable went up by 10,000. We have to adjust the receivable and we have to book the gain. That's the first thing we have to do. Now remember, we have a gain on the receivable, but we have a hedging instrument. The hedging instrument works exactly the opposite of the hedging. So if we have a gain on the receivable, we're going to have a loss on the hedging instrument because we waited too long. Therefore, we're going to have a loss of 10,783, and this is a loss, and this loss goes to the income statement, and we're going to have a forward contract, which is a liability. Now, why do we have a loss of 10,738? Because if we would have waited until December 31st, we could have got a better deal on our forward contract, but we did not wait. Therefore, we have a loss of 10,783. To record the forward contract as a liability, so we have to put a liability and to put the loss on the income statement. Okay, so notice we have a gain of 10,000, a loss of 10,783. They both go on the income statement and they cancel each other out, and overall we have a loss of 783. Simply put, now if you don't know where the 10,783 coming from, look at the prior session. Basically what happened is for this 10,783 is it's an $11,000 loss, but it's discounted at 10,783. Just look at the prior recording. I don't want to go over this. I just want to make sure you understand it. So this is the loss. Okay. Now, so again, on year one net income, this is the net loss. So on the income statement, we recorded a sale of 1.5 million on December 1st. Then as a result, we have a loss from the hedging position. The loss is 783. Overall, the impact on net income from this transaction is positive 1,499,217. On the balance sheet, we will have a receivable of 1,510. It was originally 1.5. Then we added the $10,000 with the foreign currency exchange. Then we had a liability. We had to book a liability, forward contract, and retained earning is this much as a result of this transaction, went up this much, which is net income. Now, what I suggest you do is to keep track of all these accounts, keep track of the receivable, keep track of the liability, because you're going to see how they're going to be removed by March 1st once we do have the, once we receive the money. So So let's go to March 1st. On March 1st, the rate is $48. The rate is $48. As a result, our receivable did bad, went down 30,000 because the rate was $51. It went down to $48. So we lost 3 pennies times 1 million. We have a loss of 30,000. So first we have to adjust the receivable, the fair value. Then we're gonna record a gain. On the contract, on the forward contract, we have a gain. If we have a loss on the receivable, the hedging instrument worked the opposite way. We have a gain. Now notice we have a gain of 15,783. Now again, both of these, the loss of 30,000 and the gain of 15,783, they go on the income statement and they cancel each other out. Okay? And notice we reduce our forward contract, which is the liability. The liability that we created earlier. So that's why I told you to keep track of the liability. Remember, we had a liability recorded in the prior of 10,000. The liability was 10,783. This was the liability value. Now we reduced it by 10,783. Therefore, we have, in a sense, we have a net positive in the liability, which is a debit, which is basically technically a gain. Then we settle the transaction. Settling the transaction, it means we're going to get cash, 1,485,000. Why 1,485,000? Because we signed the contract with the bank that they're going to give us the rate 1.485. Okay, therefore, this is how much cash we receive. Now, we credit the receivable, 1,480,000. Again, you could break this into two transactions, debit foreign currency, but basically this debit and credit foreign currency can be eliminated. Cash is 1,485,000. The receivable is 1,480,000. That's the balance in your receivable. And you have to eliminate the forward contract of 5,000. Simply put, this 5,000 is your gain, is your net gain on this transaction. Simply put, it's the same thing as the cash flow hedge that we worked earlier. The gain was 5,000, except here things went to the income statement up front. Okay, so foreign exchange loss in year two is 30,000, and the gain from the contract was 15,783, because the value of the currency worked against us. The receivable went down. We had a gain on the forward contract of 15,783. So overall, we had a net loss in year two of 14,217. Now, this is year two loss, plus add year one loss, 873. So we received $15,000 less. So we have losses in both years, total of 15,000. Simply put, we were supposed to receive 1.5 million. We only received 1,485,000. That's still better than if we did not hedge the position. If you look at the beginning of the session, we received cash 1,450,000 when we had no protection. When we had no protection, this is how much cash we received. Now we received 1,485,000. Well, we have $5,000 more, okay? So it's good. So the hedging position worked for us overall, and we had a net gain of 5,000. Our goal was not to make a gain from this hedging position. Having a gain is good, but our goal is to make sure we receive 1,485,000, because the risk is if we don't hedge it, we would only receive maybe 1,400,000 if we did not hedge and the value of the currency worked against us. Now, we don't care if it went up. That's not our concern. We're not trying to make money on foreign currency, okay? So under the fair value hedge, the original contract discount, again, is not amortized. Remember this. Income is the difference between the foreign exchange gain or loss of the receivable and the gain or loss on the forward contract. That is, 15,000 for year one and year two. Remember, if your receivable goes down, the hedge goes up. If your receivable goes up, the hedge position goes down. That's what hedging is. They work against each other to cancel each other out. So the net impact on net income over 2 years is 15,000. I just showed you this here, which reflects the cost of extending credit to a Spanish customer. And that's part of extending credit. The net gain on the forward contract is 5,000. Okay? Remember, we had a loss of 10,783 in year one. We had a liability in year two. It reversed. And we had a gain of 15,783. Remember, I told you had like a net positive liability. So the net is 5,000. Net positive liability, I put this in quote. Okay? That's an increase in cash flow. So simply put, this is how the fair value hedge work. So it's the accounting is different. And the company will have to decide whether they're going to account for it as a cash flow hedge or a fair value hedge. In the next session, we're going to be looking at different type of hedging, but basically we're going to go into the foreign currency option, basically looking at to have a put option or a call option to hedge a recognized foreign currency, you know, maybe would look at a denominated asset. If you have any questions, any comments, please email me. If you happen to visit my website, please consider donating. If you're studying for your CPA exam, as always, study hard. It's worth it. Good luck and see you on the other side of success.